work on a fairly theoretical area, and so I think this is better than showing you equations. So, my background, I did a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in statistics at NC State. I worked in industry for 2 years at a contract research organization. Then I did my PhD at Virginia Tech in industrial and systems engineering and spent 2 years as a postdoctoral associate in the School of Operations Research and Information Engineering at Cornell University. And I've been a professor here since 2013. So my area is broadly operations research. Within that, I work on Monte Carlo simulation. And within that, I'm a methods person. So I know that you've heard from Professor Wan. I'm not exactly sure what she covered. Sometimes she'll say that she's more applied and I'm more theory. I think this is mostly our choices. She enjoys being more applied and I enjoy being more theoretical, although I do work on application and Professor Wan also works on theory. So it's just our emphasis choice. So some keywords if you're not familiar with these terms: probability, statistics, optimization, theory, methods, algorithms, proofs. These are the kinds of things I work on. So more important than these kinds of topics and giving you more details, because I think you can get more details by taking classes, we can talk, we can have an appointment and discuss, is for you to understand some of my philosophies on advising. Different professors have different philosophies on advising, so I would encourage you to ask if you're considering someone to be your advisor, ask them what their philosophies are. So for me, advising is a service, and so that means that I'm here to help you achieve your goals. Every student is different, and so my goal is to see you succeed in doing the things that make you happy, and to attempt to tailor an experience that will help you succeed. So your success is my success. One of my goals is to create future colleagues and future professors. So when the advisor-advisee relationship works really well, the big bonus is that you get a lifelong colleague. You can often end up collaborating with this person for the rest of your career. The process of becoming a student and advisor is a mutual decision. So you would have to pick me and I would have to pick you back. It's kind of a decision that you decide, you know, I'm going to work with you and you're going to work with me and away we go. So things that I value in students, and each of these can be developed. So if you look at the list and you're short on something, you can work on them and hopefully develop them in time. So the first one is that the piece of paper at the end is not the only goal. So are you here to learn? Research is learning. Right, so we have a research question, it's something that nobody knows, and your goal is to find the answer. That's what learning is. And so hopefully your focus is to learn as opposed to obtaining a credential or something like that. Hopefully as you're excited about the material, then your focus will become learning even if it isn't right now. So these can be developed with your interest. Enthusiasm and collegiality. So is it fun to work with you? You're already here. You're smart enough to be here. This is not a concern, right? Do you have integrity when you say something? Can I trust you? Are you honest? Do you show up on time? Is working with you fun? Do we have a good time, right? This is important. Thinking deeply, synthesizing thoughts. So if you don't understand something, do you keep asking questions? This is a kind of being hungry, right? Do you keep asking questions until you understand fully? Or trying not to just take a surface-level interpretation, but really get at the deep underlying issue that's going on. Creativity, do you see things in new ways? Always valuable. Writing ability, can you write well in at least one language? It doesn't have to be English. So Professor Emeritus Bruce Schmeiser once told me something that I found incredibly valuable. Writing is the ability to synthesize thought. And that thought can be in any language. It can be in your native language. It doesn't matter. If you're able to synthesize your thoughts in your native language, then you eventually, we can translate or have a service translate, you will, when you're comfortable thinking in English, all the skills will translate right over. So if you struggle with writing, learn where you're comfortable, and then have a process of translation or learning as you become comfortable with English, as you're here longer, you may find that it's easier to write in English after training in another language. So these are things to develop. There is a writing, you'll have to check with the advisors, I'm gonna get the name wrong. It's like a writing clinic. And they often send out advice on writing and workshops on writing, and I'd encourage you to take advantage of those. Writing is a key skill of communication, especially for PhD students. Okay, so if you think you might like to work with me, I'd encourage you to take IE 581 in the spring. This is the class that I usually teach. And to make sure that you prepare for this class, I would encourage you to enroll right away in STAT 516 or 519, depending on your comfort. This is a probability course. They're both focused on probability theory. There's another course, STAT 511, that tends not to be sufficient. So you'll want to be enrolled in one of these two. Ideally, you've seen probability and statistics before. Things that are also valuable in that course are computing knowledge. If you're able to also take 517, if you already know 516, that's great. 517 is inference, hypothesis testing, things like that. So you can also email me or visit my website to see about other preparatory courses you might take. So in the course of IE 581, you'll get a better sense of what it means to do Monte Carlo simulation, how I view Monte Carlo simulation as essentially a probabilistic experiment on a computer, and then what it might mean to do research with me. So, and this will give us a chance to get to know each other, the mutual advisor-advisee choice. Okay, so questions about, yeah. Good question. 580 is not a prerequisite for 581. So 580 and 581 are kind of two courses that you can take either simultaneously, one and not the other. 580 tends to focus more on modeling. So in 580, you might build a simulation in Simio or Arena. I forget exactly the software they're using, but one of these types of packages. In 581, we will not be using any of those packages. We tend to code the things that we're doing, we'll code in MATLAB directly. We do a little bit of Excel, but not very much right at the beginning of the semester. So really 581 is more, it's a tool to learn probability at some level. You'll be introduced to the theory underlying simulation modeling and analysis. But when I've thought about what do I really want you to walk away from, I think it will help you solidify your knowledge, for example, from STAT 516 and 517. So the probability and statistics on a computer is a very concrete way to learn probability. So I would view it that way, in addition to potentially learning about other things. Okay, and I think I have more time. Okay, so other questions before we get into unsolicited advice? Okay. On being a graduate student. So this applies mostly to PhD students, but some of the advice will apply to everyone. If you're a PhD student, you usually only get to do a PhD once. Be selfish. If it's not right, move. Make sure your research is exciting to you. There's nothing more painful for you or your advisor than doing a research topic that is not interesting to you. Hopefully, the research project is interesting to your advisor if they wouldn't have agreed to do it with you. So make sure it's interesting all the way around. Take the wheel and work at your own pace. Ask for help when you need it. So I often encounter graduate students who are worried they're not fast enough or are particularly concerned about being fast. You're doing research. We don't have a measuring stick for speed. You're trying to answer a question no one has answered before. How can we possibly know if you're fast or slow? It's impossible, right? So go at your own pace. Go at a pace that's comfortable and learn deeply. Focus less on getting the result or the paper and more on the understanding underneath what's in the research topic. Ask for help when you need it. Sometimes you may feel that you should have known something already, but you don't. No, it's much better to just say, you know what, I know I should already know this, but I don't, and ask and learn, than to potentially go a long time and still have this embarrassing feeling that you don't know that thing you should have already known. So go ahead and ask. And third, learn deeply. Hopefully you realize the theme is learning. That's what we're here for. It can take a while to pick a research advisor. Many people come to graduate school not really knowing what they want to do. And then within that, it can take a while to pick a research topic, and you might have to do this in a loop. You go through topic 1, 2, 3 with advisor 1, and then you switch to advisor 2, and you go through 1, 2, 3 with them. It can take a while, but getting it right is worth it, right? This is important for you. We're professors. I did my thesis. I found my career. I enjoy my career. I would like to work with you, but if you decide that I'm not the right advisor for you, I will happily wish you well and help you get where you want to go, right? So it's more important, it's asymmetric that way, right? Me losing you as a student is, well, you know, maybe sad, but it doesn't affect my career the way you picking the wrong advisor will create your career, right? So if you're in the wrong, you've been launched, right? Doing a PhD launches you. And if you've been launched in the wrong direction, it's really hard to recover. Some people do. It's difficult. I've seen assistant professors who graduated in like material science and then took a left turn and went in engineering education and were successful. But this is by far the exception. Most people graduate and then they're trying to be an assistant professor or be a professional in that field. And if it wasn't right or your advisor is not helpful to you, it's just a disaster. So it's worth the effort or the extra year or whatever if you can to get it right. I know we all have extenuating circumstances and we try to deal with those, but to the extent you can get it right, it's worth it. On making good use of your time. So I'd encourage you as well to take hard classes. I've put hard in quotes because what's hard for one person is not hard for someone else. So if there's a class and you already know the material, waste of your time. If there's a class where you would learn the material on your own anyway, or a company that you want to work for would pay you to learn that material after you're hired, don't take it, right? Take something that you consider hard, that's valuable to you, and that will help you grow, right? Otherwise, easy A's is not what you're here for, right? You're here for learning. And again, focus on learning. This has many dimensions. The first one I've listed is avoid comparisons. It's very easy to have imposter syndrome. Happens to most of us. There are little demons that crop up and say, maybe I'm slow, maybe I'm not learning as well. He seems to know this already. She's a whiz at that. Why am I behind? The sooner that you learn to just focus on your own learning and your own trajectory, the happier you'll be. And I'll argue the more successful you'll be, because you're not spending half of your brain worrying about everybody else. You can finally take your whole brain and focus on learning, which is what you're here to do anyway. Right? And at the end of the day, if you learned it and they learned it, it doesn't matter how long you took, you both knew it. At the end, you know the same thing. Remember, some classes are meant to make you more sophisticated and thus more adept to handle whatever comes your way. So I often encounter students who, before they enroll in a class, will want to know how this will benefit them later in their career. And you can design a course of study that is tailored that way and be successful. But I'll ask you not to discard a class immediately because you don't see the benefit. Some classes, you will never, probably if you're getting a master's degree and going into industry, you'll probably never sit at your desk and write a proof. It's unlikely. You might, but it's unlikely. But learning how to write proofs is an important skill for learning the language of mathematics, increasing your sophistication, enabling you to handle things that come your way. There's a point of confidence when you say, yes, I can open any math book and learn what's in those pages. If you can achieve that, that's extremely valuable, even though you'll probably not go sit at your desk in company X and write proofs. Right? So don't discard these classes immediately because you don't see the benefit. It may be subtle or hidden or show up later. Again, if you're focused on just learning for its own sake, you should hopefully still enjoy the class. And finally, avoid electronic distractions. Do I end at 20 or 25? Diet? Do you know what time I end, 20 or 25? 25. Okay, excellent. So we have a little time. So you're probably aware that we are a highly distracted society by electronics. And you're entering a market where concentration is everything. Tasks that do not require concentration are likely to be outsourced to a robot, to a computer, to an algorithm, to somebody who will be paid less than you would like to be paid, given that you have an engineering degree from Purdue, right? So it behooves you to develop your ability to concentrate. And this effort extends throughout your life, inside, outside class. What I see mostly is inside class, and I can tell you what I've seen over a couple of years. So when I first started teaching, I taught in a classroom with, we'll call it infinite board space, because I had three boards, and I could raise those and get three more boards, and I could raise those and get still three more boards. So I never had to erase anything. And class went great, it was fine. Then I was forced to teach in a class with just a panel of three boards. And all of a sudden I had to erase things. And I learned that if I erase one of the boards very slowly, and I turn around to the class, there will be two or three questions waiting for me. Because I've given them a pause, I've given them time to digest what we just learned, and now they've thought about it and they have a question. And this was great, because now we're having a discussion. We're interacting, we're answering questions, we're exploring the material more deeply, and this is a lot of fun for everybody, at least I think. Fun for me, certainly. Lately, when I teach in the same style, I turn around and what do you think the class is doing? They are checking their phones. This changes your ability to learn and interact with your colleagues. Right? The benefit of being in person is that we can have these discussions. You can ask me questions. You can benefit from the questions of your colleagues. I'll argue that if this is the way you'll approach class, first of all, it's bad for your brain. Right? You're not concentrating in one stream of thought on one topic. But second, you might be better off learning from a video. You can't pause me, but you could pause a video and finish your message and come back. Right? So what we have when you're in person, in class, on campus, is unique. And so I'll urge you to turn off your phone, leave it in your bag, in part because this is a courteous thing to do. I would encourage you all to be courteous, but also because I think it benefits you. And it enables us as a class, if we all agree, to have an experience that is unique, that you can't just go get by watching MIT online courseware, right? So I will leave you with that.